when it is dark enough, you can see the stars. Over the centuries, we have looked to the heavens, first for divination, and then for knowledge, unlocking keys to how the universe was formed, opening doors of perception, scientific exploration, and understanding. We have dared to venture beyond the confines of our own fragile atmosphere, always exploring, forever voyaging. And from a sky filled with stars, we are given a chance to look into a distant past to discover once again how the voyage began. In the most rarefied air on a string of jewels in the tropics, perched upon the highest volcanoes on the earth, lie the great telescopes. It is here, on the summit of Haleakalā, House of the Sun, that men and women of science, following in the footprints of a great Polynesian god that came before, find themselves once more on the very brink of discovery. For 50 years, Haleakalā has been a world-class observatory for astronomy and space research. Its accomplishments are legion, and contributions made to science and national defense immeasurable. But these are not the first wayfarers to walk upon this mountain and ponder the heavens above.
The first people to come to Hawaii were the Polynesians who became the Hawaiians. We know that they were great navigators. Their understanding of nature, which included the stars, was pretty phenomenal. These big mountains, that what I understand, were really their learning sanctuaries. They certainly used them as a place for studying, but they were great astronomers as well as oceanographers or meteorologists, whatever the kinds of ways we define people who study and understand nature today. They were all of that. Otherwise, they would not have been able to explore so vast and such huge parts of the planet's oceans.
Navigating by sun, moon, and stars, wind, waves, the movements of fish and birds, by sight, sound, smell, taste, and intuition. They sailed without instruments in sleek ocean-going canoes. A people of the sea, the Polynesians became, and still are, in terms of area, the most widespread culture on the face of the earth, covering an expanse of 10 million square miles, a great ocean nation, with more than 600 times more water than land. They colonized the entire Polynesian Triangle, from New Zealand in the south, Rapa Nui or Easter Island in the east, and the Hawaiian Islands in the north. And they did this 1,000 years before Columbus was born.
They had to have, I would say it's traditional science, but it's really relationship to the natural world. And it was us folks that sail now, we're just students of them and children of them, and we're just beginning to understand the depth of their understanding of the Earth's natural systems and how they live within it.
They came, the ancient chants tell us, from Kahiki, a place far off. They sailed in great voyaging canoes made from giant trees to islands forged in fire. To the very mountain beneath our feet, Haleakalā, sacred house of the sun. And if we call it by the ancient name, Haleakalā, the path to call the sun. Haleakalā Crater is an erosional depression covering an area of more than 700 acres. Measured from the summit, it is 7.5 miles long and 2.5 miles wide. It is 3,000 feet deep with a circumference of nearly 22 miles. But to the Hawaiian, to describe it this way says nothing of its true dimension.
The house of the sun, or calling of the sun, as we coined it, the Hawaiians called it, it's very, very appropriate. That's where the sun lives.
You know, in a Hawaiian way of thinking, Haleakalā is our ancestor. It has been here much longer than any of us. It was here and it helped create these islands. So it is definitely our ancestor. We have come after and we have been allowed to be here and to visit and to see. And it is our ancestor who allows us to do that. So when you look at Haleakalā, look at it like your family.
Haleakalā is sacred, and sacred places need to be taken care of.
Haleakalā is the place where a great Polynesian demigod, Maui, snared and slowed the sun to help dry the tapa cloth of Hina, his beloved mother. It is a place that was home to Pele, a revered goddess of fire, who gave her life and whose bones are buried here. Emerging from a hot spot on the seafloor nearly 2 million years ago, Haleakalā has risen in a cycle of eruption and erosion to become one of the most massive volcanoes on the Earth. It is a place of opposites, where the extremes of its barren alpine aeolian zone bring summer every day and winter every night. A place where you can travel through as many climates in the 20 miles from the summit to Kaupo as you would going from Alaska to the tip of Mexico. A place where long ago, car-sized lava bombs of molten rock spit from giant cinder cones, cooled in the air, and crashed back to Earth, leaving odd-shaped rocks that still mark the crater floor. It is a place of great attraction, so much so that standing on Magnetic Peak, just below the summit, will cause a compass needle to flex away from true north. A place where eons ago, Canadian geese flying south for the winter got thrown off course in a storm and were marooned here, only to evolve into a species of their own, the rare endangered nene. It is a place where the air is clearer and cleaner than just about any place else. A place of stunning biological diversity. Where bamboo forests, redwoods, subalpine shrublands, and lush rainforests coexist within a few miles distance from each other. A place where one can find parched earth and tumbling waterfalls. Where lichens appear as giant forest tapestries. Herbs grow as big as trees. And carnivorous caterpillars patrol deep impenetrable rainforests. A place that shelters thousands of exquisite, rare, and endangered plant and animal species found nowhere else on the planet. A place where there are dozens of names for wind and rain. The Pe'epa Pohaku hide behind rocks rain at Taupō. The Ukiukiu rain of Makawao. The red and yellow Ulalena rain of Pi'iholo. The Lilinoi rain of Haleakalā.
Per square mile, you know, Haleakalā is an amazing place. There's more packed into it in terms of numbers of endemic species, numbers of culturally important sites. You know, just when you throw in the height of the volcano, the way that Haleakalā drops on its leeward side in probably 4 miles all the way down to the sea is one of the most spectacular slopes in the world. And if you were to walk around it or walk, you know, most people don't, but if you were to walk around Haleakalā or you were to walk over the top of Haleakalā in almost any direction, I think it would be a pretty amazing voyage for the number of miles from country that's so dense you can barely push your way through it to really open rocky landscapes, big open grasslands that might lie for miles. Some places look like Montana, other places look like the moon. Other places look like the most tangled rainforest you could possibly imagine. And you crossed over an area that, at least if you measured it as the crow flies, is only a relatively few miles. And many of these areas on the mountain haven't been explored even. Until the 1980s, many of the areas that we first went into, no one had ever been there. Kind of an amazing concept, you know, in the United States.
And although this may indeed be an amazing concept to some, for the Kanaka Maoli, or true Hawaiian, it makes perfect sense. There are certain places man should be wary to enter. These are the Vau Akua, realms of the gods.
A mauna, or a great mountain like Haleakalā, in Hawaiian thinking, as you approach higher and higher levels to the summit, for example, of a mountain, this is where the highest levels of beings, or akua, or supernatural beings, live. Yeah, we as humans would live down. As you went upland, you went to what you call the Wau Akua, the places of the gods. And of course, at the summit, or the pico, is where the great gods existed, lived, and walked upon the earth.
What's in front of you, it is amazing. If you look at what's there, this massive crater, this thing like you're on the moon, but how close you are to the elements. You know, you're right there with the elements. Hawaiian said you're closest to God when you're up in Haleakalā. And you are. You know, Haleakalā was a burial for the Hawaiian people. Lele'ivi is a place where they used to throw their dead over, the bones of their dead, because they felt the crater was a receptacle of where the gods lived.
Anywhere you lay your bones is where you have decided this part of you will remain, that it will no longer wander, that this part of you will be here.
The structures up there are not just rocks, but they are remnants or elements of this realm or world where the gods and goddesses walk and live. It's that memory, again, of who am I as a kanaka, as a person, as a Hawaiian. Each time one of those sites are destroyed or disturbed, it's part of my own self being destroyed and disturbed. Because I am a descendant. I'm a direct descendant of those who came before me. What's interesting about Haleakalā, within the crater, we all know there's all these pool or hilltops, all these high peaks. Every one of those high peaks are also significant in their own way. And that's why you find most of them named after gods or goddesses or people of supernatural power. Maui, Hina, associated with Kamuhoali'i, and so on and so on and so on. So again, because this is their realm.
Hanaukapu.
In Hawaiian thinking, you never really went up to the top unless you had some kind of specific purpose. And for Haleakalā, for example, you know, one of the lessons in my family was, this is the remnants of Pele also, that exist in her forms up on the summit of Haleakalā. So you would never, for example, move or take anything away from the summit in itself, because that is an encroachment upon the realm of Pele as the creator, the physical creator of these islands through her manifestation as the lava.
It's Pele's essence of her body. It's part of her body. In no words, it's, you know, in simple words, it's her kinolau. It's her, the essence, her steam, the cinders and the rock.
For us, Pele is ohana. She is family because she came with her family from Polapola, from the south, and traveled up upon her canoe to get here to Hawaii. She brought her brothers and sisters with her. Her brother was the shark god that guided their canoe up to Hawaii, and it was through him that the family comes to settle here.
This is where Pele, according to the Pele histories, came, chose to use this as a home. It wasn't really a good place for her, in that hard to keep the embers burning or the fires going. So it was just a matter of time before they moved on. But what forces the hand is the arrival of her sister Namakau Kaha'i, who was a mo'o, a sea dragon goddess, if you will.
So she chased Pele from island to island. As a sea goddess, when Pele pounded her magical digging stick into the ground to make these craters and to make the lava flow, Namakau Kaha'i, who was her sister, would rush in from beneath and put out her fire. Then she must move on to the next crater. And so it went throughout the craters that dot upon our land.
She catches Pele here. They have a huge battle.
And in that great battle, Pele, the goddess of fire and volcano, and Namakau Kaha'i, the goddess of the ocean, fight.
Oh, I can't.
Pele ends up being slain.
Because of that, Pele's bones are gathered up and placed in a hillside known as Ka'iwi o Pele. That means the bones of Pele. But all was not lost, because the greater gods, greater than Pele and the Maka o Kaha'i, take pity on Pele and turn her into an everlasting spirit.
After her mortal body, if you will, is done away with, the spirit rises above Mauna Kea across the channel. And that's what the Maka o Kaha'i sees.
Her spirit rose up, and all of a sudden, weeks after, they see smoke on Mauna Kea. And they say, ah, oya no, Pele. Pele is present, you know? And Pele then resided in all this Panaeva forest she burnt, and, you know, and continuously, even till now, she's bringing out fingers of lava and creating more land.
You understand the greatness of creation, whatever you want to call it. If you want to call it magma, lava, you know, the creating of a volcano, or what have you. Our culture just so happens to believe that it was created in the same way that a scientist believes, from the ocean floor up, and that the goddess that moved here became the goddess of this place. And as she moved on and settled on Hawaii to her permanent home where the lava is still erupting, there she is celebrated. But this place is still revered for its magnificence, whether it's viewed in a cultural aspect or in a scientific one. And either way, there is grandeur in it. So there should be reverence and respect for it.
Since Haleakalā is an active volcano, we know that Madam Pele may one day return to the slopes above Honuaula. But for now, in an endless play of opposites, the mountain is under the dominion of a different goddess, a goddess of moisture, who comes here every day, Lilinoi, goddess of the mist.
Lilinoi is Haleakalā. Lilinoi is the goddess of the mist, and that is Haleakalā, that is her special place.
It is Lilinoi that nourishes the mysterious Ahinahina, or silver sword, an extremely rare relative of the sunflower that only grows on Haleakalā. Little shiny fibers on its leaves that have the appearance of moonlight actually reach out and grab moisture as well as provide protection from the burning rays of the sun. A greatly endangered plant found nowhere else on Earth, it relies on a unique ohana or family of insects for pollination. Insects who are themselves threatened by a looming invasion of the deadly Argentinian ant. Only able to thrive in the loose red cinder of high elevations, the Ahinahina's shallow root system extends 15 feet out from its base, making the plant's survival extremely vulnerable to the careless footprints of anyone walking near or around it. It is a plant that flowers only once in a lifetime before it dies, returning its essence to the only mountain it will ever know.
I was born and raised in the Hawaiian Islands, but I had no idea how unique they were. I thought that the Hawaiian Islands were like Kentucky, that they were just small islands in the Pacific that were just like any other place in the mainland. But the Hawaiian Islands are extremely unique in almost every aspect of their major physical nature and biological nature. For me, That's the thing that stands out about Haleakalā now, and you add to that great beauty. And I feel that very profoundly when I look across ecosystems that are covered with endemic forests, that are teeming with millions of birds early in the morning. They're all calling together. Species, if you go down with a specialist, which I've done a number of times, you find 10, 20 new species in a transect. Hawaii is a special place. It's clearly special, and on top of that, it's clearly beautiful. The most important thing for me is completely unique. I mean, it has no analog. There is no other place, and I don't know how many other places in the world can say that, you know, but it really has no analog. It has no comparison.
Nestled along Haleakalā's windward slopes at high elevation above Hana, the most Hawaiian place, lies a case in point, Hana V, a rainforest realm of enchantment, as wild and untamed as any place on earth. Part of the sacred Vau'akua, realm of the gods, this forest of the gods has changed very little in 2,000 years. The ancient proverb says, "Hahai no ka'ua I ka ululaau," rains always follow the forest. And there are areas in these uplands that see as much as 400 inches of rain per year. Water is a source of life. Water from the greater gods Lono and Kane originates here and cascades down through the Vau'kanaka, the realm of man, all the way down to the ocean, percolating through the aquifer, feeding the taro, nourishing the plants Hawaiians use for medicine, food, and adornment, and bringing life to everyone and everything in its path. Hana V is a native land, a kingdom still ruled by birds. From brown little finch-like birds, blown here in a storm more than a million years ago, several species of rare forest honeycreepers evolved. Each with its favorite flower or food that has co-evolved to match its beak. This Iivi's favorite is a rare lobelia. This Maui crested honeycreeper, a kohekohe, prefers the sacred lehua flower of the ohia tree, a tree so full of mana or spiritual power that if one was cut in ancient times for ritual purposes, a human sacrifice was required in exchange. More than 85 species of forest birds have already left this world forever, and 32 more are teetering on the brink of extinction. Yet they go on singing. These are songs we may never hear again. And this is a mele, or song composed by a 19th century Hawaiian, Queen Kapi'olani, for the bird that dwells in a forest, and for a chief gone forever. When one leaves the Vau Akua and descends further down the slopes of Haleakalā, one enters the Vau Kanaka, or realm of man, where city lights have replaced the torches of old, ground nesting birds are no more, and sugarcane now rustles in the wind. Haleakalā's leeward dryland forests, receiving from 10 to 60 inches of rain per year, were once more extensive than its rainforests and a source for native plants like mamane, sandalwood, and koa.
The southern slopes of Haleakalā at one time, you know, had some of the greatest dryland forests, koa, nio, other great trees. We look at that as a watershed. What we see now today is basically 5% of what once existed on the slopes.
In the Vau Kanaka, realm of man, the fragrant sandalwood was cut for profit, and much of the land, once covered with forest, was cleared for ranching and pasture land. And the mountain has other interlopers as well. If not fenced out, wild goats, feral pigs, axis deer and cattle will roam Haleakalā at large, eating native plants like ice cream. Feral cats and night stalking rats will raid nests, eat eggs, and kill native birds. The deadly mongoose will do the same, as well as dig up turtle nests for hatchlings and eggs. Non-native lizards will swallow birds whole, and strange frogs will pierce the night with alien cries. Invasive plants will choke off native plant species, killing Pele's children, the seedlings of the koa and ohia, before they have a chance to grow, disturbing a delicate balance that has existed for thousands of years.
We have a natural tendency to disturb this balance. We encroach upon this balance. So we have to be very careful, very understanding not to disturb it too much.
And in order for us to learn how not to disturb it too much, it helps to try and understand the connection Hawaiians have always had to the aina, the land. And to the ocean from which it was born.
The aina. Aina, I means to eat. Na is the. So aina means the mystical food of the land. That's how Hawaiians looked at land. It's a mystical food. It sustains us. It gives back to us if we take care of it.
And in our world, everything is related to one another. there is a corresponding animal in the ocean to one that's on land. And when that flower blooms from that plant, that particular mollusk or fish or what have you is spawning at the same time. That's how astute they were to observe their world. And not only that, as the ocean creature disappears, its land correspondent does too. That's the sad part.
Born as a male for the narrow stream, the female for the broad stream. Born as a turtle living in the sea, guarded by the male seedling living on land.
In Hawaii, in our time, it is the va'a or kanu that provides a living culture with a link to the past. It also holds the keys to the future for all of Polynesia. The kanu is the spaceship of the ancestors. Koa is a sacred tree from which the kanu is made. One of the last koa forests still stands in the ahupua'a of Kipuhulu in the Vau Kanaka, halfway up the slopes of Haleakalā. And what we are about to witness, for the first time in nearly three generations, is the harvest of a koa canoe in the old way. This is more than reverence. This is adoration. And although today's Hawaiians use modern tools to fell and carve the tree, a tradition that was almost lost continues.
We're at the elevation of 2,350 feet on Haleakalā, and about 3 miles. Right now, this is our third day. We have with us a whole bunch of people. Fafa is the kahuna kalai va'a, or the master kanu maker. It took each and every one of us to a different level of understanding our own lives in what we're doing today.
In a very real way, it is the kanu that helps shape the culture. It is the voyage that helps shape who you become. Who are your companions? What sustains you through your perilous journey across the open ocean of life? How do you relate to the elements that surround you? Who are you? Where are you? What is your sense of place? What star guides you in the darkest of nights?
Looking at the stars for me, at least the way that I was taught, I mean, it invokes many things. It invokes my teachers, it invokes a connection to my heritage in a special way. When I look at the stars now, I'm looking at those pin lights that maybe 1,000 years ago Ohana, a family, had used them to find Tahiti and used them to find Hawaii. So yeah, the stars are, for me, more than just for navigation. They're like some of my deepest friends, because they're always there, and they're always things that I can trust, especially when I'm out at the ocean, trying to bring islands out of the ocean. I can trust the stars, so they're very, very good friends.
You want to know anything about Hawaiian culture? Look in the chants. Look in the stories. They are all there. These same chants tell us what Haleakalā was about and what our kupuna felt was important about that mountain. They talk about the winds and the rains and the majesty of the clouds and the different kinds of gods and goddesses that dwell there. They tell us that this mountain is for us to respect and for us to love. They tell us that this mountain is our ancestor, that this mountain is our sibling. As family members, we must care for it as much as we care for anyone else in our family. You don't have to know exactly what is being said. You are carried away by the sound of it and by the movement of it. You read and you get from it what you can understand, and that is enough.
For me, I can feel the land. If you go up to the crater or go into water down the beach, you can feel the force of energy. I can sit on Haleakalā and I can feel everything vibrating. I can feel that. You cannot feel it through concrete. You cannot feel it through asphalt. You cannot. You gotta see the dirt, see the lepo. The lepo, the earth, the honua, the Mother Earth is where it's all at.
I don't think anybody's asking anybody to believe that rocks are spiritual here if you don't believe that. But please respect that Hawaiians truly believe this. This is not a line that they give something. These are the bones of Pele. These are clear physical symbols to them. And if it would be somebody walking in, marching to the Sistine Chapel and picking up something and saying, "You think this is sacred? Well, explain to me why it is." You know, it doesn't, you don't have, as another culture, you almost don't have the right to do that. You just have to respect, you know, what is and what other cultures believe.
This is a holy place for people. So I should not enter as a human being into another place to impose and encroach my own philosophies, because again, that's detrimental to the sacredness and the holiness of that place. So in the same way with Haleakalā, if people understood Haleakalā as being like our church.
Haleakalā is a church, but isn't this entire earth one too? Isn't this the greatest cathedral that you could ever be a part of? So yes, for the Hawaiians in our world, this is a church. It doesn't have the kind of four wall structures and a roof that you know, we oftentimes think about in that sense, but it's a church, and so is Mother Earth. Haleakalā is a beautiful crater, beautiful mountain. Makes you realize how insignificant you are. And how lucky you are to live here.
Oh, my God.